My name's Jane Langdale. I work at the University of Oxford and I'm involved in a big international collaborative project to engineer plants to use a more efficient form of photosynthesis. So specifically to engineer rice to use a type of photosynthesis called C4 photosynthesis, which is the type that maize normally uses. Well, they are huge, but maybe if I just focus on why we're working specifically with rice. So right now across Asia, a hectare of land has to feed 27 people. By 2050, that same hectare is going to have to feed 43 people. And so clearly there's got to be an increase in yield. And that increase in yield is being achieved at a slow rate by traditional breeding at the moment. So at the moment, you get about a 1% increase in yield per year. And that's not going to deliver the types of increases that are needed that are going to come about not only because of population increases, but also because there's more competition for land, particularly in Asia. As more land gets urbanized and people move to the city, then the amount of agricultural land available decreases. My research aims to convert rice into using a photosynthetic pathway that's normally used by maize. So rice is what's known as a C3 plant, and C3 plants fix CO2 using the enzyme Rubisco. And Rubisco can also interact with oxygen. And if it does interact with oxygen, then essentially the efficiency of photosynthesis for the plant is decreased. And the oxygenation reaction occurs in high temperatures and in dry conditions. C4 plants have evolved a way to overcome that problem by compartmentalizing photosynthesis into two distinct cell types. In the first cell type, there is a carboxylase enzyme that's insensitive to oxygen. And so CO2 comes into that cell, gets fixed by PEP carboxylase, and then the product of that reaction gets shuttled into a second cell type, the bundle sheath, where Rubisco accumulates. And that C4 product, 4-carbon compound that's formed when PEP carboxylase reacts with CO2, gets decarboxylated in those bundle sheath cells, and the CO2 released from that is then in the presence of Rubisco. And so this acts as a concentrating mechanism. So there's a double system whereby, first of all, the CO2 and the oxygen are exposed to PEP carboxylase. PEP carboxylase doesn't care that there's oxygen around. It gets on and efficiently fixes the CO2. And then when the CO2 is re-released in the bundle sheet cells where Rubisco is, there's a high concentration of it around the enzyme, and the oxygen is also one cell further away. And so that the interaction between oxygen and Rubisco doesn't occur. As a consequence, the efficiency of C4 photosynthesis is much greater. And so what our research aims to do is make rice use that C4 pathway, and in so doing, increase the efficiency of photosynthesis and therefore increase yield. So in order to convert rice into a plant that can use the C4 path, we've got to do a number of things. First of all, we've got to make sure that the enzymes, the CO2 fixation enzymes, both PEP carboxylase and Rubisco, accumulate in the correct cell type. They mustn't be in the same cell type. That requires, in case of PEP carboxylase, increasing the level of gene expression. And in the case of both of the enzymes, we need to make sure that the gene expression occurs only in the right cell type. We also have to engineer the other enzymes involved in the C4 pathway, and again, they have to be produced and accumulate in the right cell type. And of course, I keep saying in the right cell type. And to do that, to make sure there are the right cell types, we've got to change the leaf anatomy, because a rice plant has leaf anatomy whereby they have two veins separated by up to 10, 15 mesophyll cells, all of which accumulate Rubisco and will carry out the C3 pathway. Whereas a C4 plant has a vein, a photosynthetic bundle sheath next to it, a photosynthetic mesophyll next to that, and then that pattern repeats. So you go vein, bundle sheath, mesophyll, mesophyll, bundle sheath, vein. And so that unit, that repeating unit, has to occur all the way across the leaf. And we have to be able to engineer and alter the leaf structure in rice so that that happens. And so in a nutshell, what we've got to do is we've got to change the anatomy, we've got to change the biochemistry, and we've got to do a little bit of fine tuning to make it work properly. This is a huge challenge. This is the project at the moment is being carried out by a global consortium of 11 labs in a number of different countries. It's funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. We are in phase two of the project. Phase one was 3 years, phase two is 3 years. It will be at least another 10, 15 years before this product would get into the field to the point at which people would actually be able to eat it. The potential outcomes are substantial. So it has been modelled that we should be able to increase yield by 50%. And if you remember, I was saying that traditional breeding is only increasing yield by about 1% each year. So to get a 50% increase will deliver that increase that's needed to match the population rise. And also, because C4 plants are more efficient, then there will need to be less nitrogen fertilizer applied. So the nitrogen use efficiency will be better, and also the water use efficiency, because C4 plants need less water. And so it's basically a triple hit. You increase yield with less nitrogen and less water. So it's win-win-win. The new generation of scientists are absolutely crucial to projects such as these. So when this project started, I already knew I was likely to be retired before it finished. These are long-term, extremely challenging goals, and we need new people engaged in those projects all the time. And I have to say, actually, since I've been involved in this project, it's a project that many of the undergraduate students that I come across are just desperate to be involved with. They want to help, and they see the excitement, and they see the potential value of doing this research. And it's not just because of the output, the translational output of it. There's some serious fundamental science to be done here. You know, we need to understand how that leaf anatomy develops. We need to understand exactly how the metabolic pathway works in a C4 plant, let alone engineering into a C3 plant. So these are big fundamental questions, and it requires my generation, but it requires the next generation too. It's exciting times.